Hello, everyone. Welcome to Healthcare and Beyond. Good evening, and welcome to Healthcare and Beyond. I'm Dr. Lawrence Rosenberg, your host, and we have a great show for you this evening. We have a great guest for you this evening. Our healthcare system, as I've spoken about in the past, is immense. It's complex, it's complicated, it's labyrinthine, and it's enormous. Our healthcare system is a $2.9 trillion system. Which is on a par, believe it or not, with the gross domestic product of Brazil. So our healthcare system is the size of a large country. Brazil is about the sixth or seventh largest country in the world. And there's so many people invested in our system. There's so many stakeholders in our healthcare system. We have the people who work for drug companies. We have people who work for diagnostic companies, medical device companies, hospitals, doctors, nurses, insurance companies, regulatory agencies, and all these people are invested in the system. But when you look at the system, what it comes down to, the center of the system, if you will, the nexus of the system, the fulcrum of our system, is really that doctor-patient experience. So you can imagine how important is the way in which we educate our doctors and the way in which we train our doctors. Because this generation of doctors that are being educated, that are going to medical school, that are undergoing the residency training, is going to be the generation of doctors in a few years that will come out and make those decisions. Those decisions such as what drugs we're going to prescribe, what medications we're going to prescribe, what medical devices we're going to use, what diagnostic studies, what the future of medical research will hold, what the standard of care will be. So all these decisions are going to shape the medical system and the healthcare system of the future. We are very fortunate today because we have Dr. Stephen Scheinman, who is the Dean of Commonwealth Medical College, here with us to talk about medical education, to talk about the future of residency education, and really the future of our healthcare system. He has an enormous responsibility, and along with a handful of other deans in the country, will really help to shape our system going forward by educating our medical students and our residents going forward. I want to read just a few notes here about Dr. Scheinman. He is president and dean of the Commonwealth Medical College in Scranton, Pennsylvania, since September of 2012. Dr. Scheinman came to Commonwealth from SUNY Upstate Medical College, where he served as professor of medicine and pharmacology, and for 8 years as senior vice president and dean of the college. Dr. Scheinman has been invited to numerous national and international meetings and a visiting professor at many prominent universities in the United States and abroad. He is currently serving on the National Medical Board's the National Resident Match Program, a member of the Pennsylvania Legislative Advisory Committee on the Physician Workforce. He is a graduate of Amherst College and Yale University Medical School and did his training in nephrology and medicine at both Yale University and at Upstate Medical Center. He is also the author of some 60 peer-reviewed articles and book chapters. So it is a real pleasure to have him with us today. Welcome, Dr. Scheinman. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much. I'm thrilled to be here.
It is a pleasure. It's really a pleasure. We have a lot to talk about. There's a lot going on in the healthcare system. There's a lot going on in medical education. But I want to talk first about Commonwealth Medical College. How did the idea to build a medical school in Northeast Pennsylvania come about? Where was the need perceived? And sort of how did things proceed along? And then how did you get involved in it?
Well, TCMC originated from the vision of some founders who got together over breakfast every week, beginning this month, 10 years ago, in Northeast Pennsylvania. They were concerned that the population was aging and their medical needs were increasing, at the same time as the physician workforce was aging out and retiring. And it was frankly difficult to recruit physicians to an economically depressed corner of the state. Right. And so they came up with a dream that many people told them would be impossible, to create a medical school. There had been no new medical schools created in the United States since the 1970s.
Really?
Yes, until 2004, when the first of this new group of medical schools was started in Florida. Mm-hmm. There are 16 new medical schools that have graduated medical students. We are the most recent of those. Okay. There's another half dozen in the pipeline emerging. Of those first 16 in the 21st century, 11 were founded by hospital systems seeking to feed their workforce.
Feed the pipeline.
Right.
Yeah.
And 4 were founded by universities wanting to have the prestige of a medical school. Mm-hmm. 1 was independent. That's us. We do not have a parent university. We are not a division of a hospital system. Mm-hmm. We're independent, which makes us unique in many ways. It allows us to chart our own course with regard to our mission and vision. And the vision of the founders was really quite clear. It was to address the workforce needs, the physician workforce needs, in Northeast and North Central Pennsylvania, in a 17-county region. It's geographically a very broad region, and we have several campuses in that region.
So we're looking, when you speak of Northeast Pennsylvania, just to kind of frame it, so Philadelphia is kind of southeast.
Yes.
And the Poconos are sort of in the middle there. So we're looking sort of Scranton eastward, more or less.
Well, the simplest way to think about our 17-county region is that it's in the northeast. It goes to the New Jersey border and the New York border, the Delaware River, separating New York and Pennsylvania.
Okay.
It goes as far west as just beyond Williamsport, which is where the Little League World Series takes place.
Okay.
We have a campus at Williamsport. Okay. And it goes south. For Pennsylvanians, they'll recognize the Lehigh Valley Tunnel as a major geographic and cultural divider in the state of Pennsylvania.
Okay.
So our territory goes to the tunnel.
Okay. Okay. So these people got together and they obviously raised some funds for the medical school. They obviously had a vision. And so how did they sort of proceed after that?
Well, they had support from the state of Pennsylvania.
Okay.
They had generous support, philanthropic support from the community. And they had quite generous support from Blue Cross of Northeast Pennsylvania,
right.
Which, and this is a unique arrangement, the support that the school has received from a major insurer.
Right.
It's really quite unique in American medical education. And Blue Cross had the vision that it could improve the care of patients in their region of Northeast Pennsylvania,
right.
If they could have a medical school producing physicians who would stay locally and replenish the physician workforce and improve the quality of care in the region.
So the goal really, I guess, is to try and populate that region with the physicians from that medical college.
Yes.
Here's an interesting thing I just thought of, and it's maybe a little bit unusual of a question, but because you're not affiliated with a university, you're not beholden to a university or, for that matter, a medical system, do you feel like that gives you more freedom to do different things with the medical college that another medical college might not be able to do?
I think it does, and I think in many ways our mission, our community-based mission,
yeah.
is really quite quite unique and might not be shared by every university that you might consider partnering with.
Yeah.
And that mission is to tie our curriculum, to tie our choice of students to the community.
Right.
And so we have many elements of our curriculum. We really describe our curriculum as community-based and patient-centered,
mm-hmm.
and innovative. There are many elements in the curriculum that tie the students, whether they come from the region or not, to the communities in the region. So we have campuses where they get their clinical experiences from their first year of medical school, where they'll spend a full week, 3 times a year in the first year, 3 times a year in the second year, a full week, 3 full weeks in each of those years before the third year of medical school, in the clinical setting with clinical mentors that they will continue with until they graduate, and getting to know patients that they will have relationships with for their full 4 years of medical school. And so we have a clinical campus in Scranton. We have a clinical campus in Wilkes-Barre,
right.
One in Williamsport, and a growing relationship with Pocono Medical Center in East Stroudsburg,
right.
They are hoping and we are hoping that they will grow to become our East campus. And at each of these sites, students will be assigned to mentors who will advise them and become their role models for their full 4 years of medical school, where they are required in their first year to pursue a research project around community health, mm-hmm. and in their second year to pursue a research project around healthcare quality, working with a practice in that region to improve a quality process within that practice. They're required to do 100 hours of community service, working with not-for-profit agencies, whether it be related to child abuse or food for the poor or services to the needy or to women, et cetera. And the curriculum during their clinical years, mm-hmm. is largely ambulatory rather than the typical medical school curriculum, which is hospital-based.
Right.
And so through all of these curricular threads, we think we achieve a really quite substantial linkage between the students and the community that they do their clinical work in.
It's interesting, and it's interesting because in my day, and perhaps probably, you know, with yourself as well, you certainly didn't traditionally begin your clinical studies until your third year. I mean, you really sat in a vacuum in a classroom for 2 years. You know, they had physical diagnosis courses at the end of your second year, but you really didn't see a patient until you were in your third year in medical school. And then the community piece is very interesting. But I think we'll get to that. I wanted to get to that in a minute. There's a lot of very interesting things taking place in medical education, and it's really fascinating to me, and it's interesting from both an educational perspective as well a medical perspective. But let's start. I want to start with this whole notion of problem-based learning, mm-hmm. because from my understanding, that's been perhaps one of the most, I guess I don't want to use the word disruptive, but structural changes in the way that doctors train and are educated now. Tell me a little bit about problem-based learning. What is it? How do you implement it? Why is it better than a traditional model?
Well, the whole paradigm of medical education is shifting towards one in which we respect the student as an active learner. There's a famous saying among medical school deans when they greet the incoming class that 50% of the information we're going to give you over the next 4 years will become useless during your time in medicine. We just don't know which 50% it is.
Especially now. Yeah.
That pace is accelerating. It's true if you consider the facts. And the paradigm that I think the public has of medical education, and what you and I largely experienced when we were in medical school, is you spend most of your day in the first 2 years sitting in a lecture hall, receiving information, yeah. going home at night, memorizing. I remember both mnemonics for all the cranial nerves.
You remember the hands? The cranial nerves?
There were mnemonics for everything because memorization was critical to medical education. It's still important to know the names of the bones and where the nerves serve. Yeah. But the whole paradigm of medical education now is moving towards one in which the student plays an active role, because the goal is to make them lifelong learners and put them in a position to be able to process information that will come to them from multiple directions throughout their career. So problem-based learning is a major part of this, whereby rather than reading about a disease, being lectured to about a disease, and perhaps even given an example of a patient with that disease, the students are posed a problem, and through that problem, they need to study about the disease to be able to address the questions embedded in that problem. And they don't do it on their own, they do it in teams. So team-based learning is another part of this, where students get together in a small group and tackle a series of problems in which they are teaching each other the answers to those problems, and the teacher is largely in the room as a resource. And so this is what we refer to as the flipped classroom, in which the students are bringing as much of the information as they've been able to garner outside of class. Mm-hmm. And we use multiple methods for that into the discussion about the cases. By doing that, I think it's a basic element of pedagogy that if you can engage a student as an active learner, they will retain not just the facts, but the process of the thought process much better than if they simply passively receive information, which will have a very transient half-life in their memories.
So let's take an example. Let's give me an example of the kind of a problem, and a very simple kind of problem, mm-hmm. and how, I mean, it seems to me, I guess from the way you describe it, is that you start with a potentially a problem that's got a great number of implications mm-hmm. clinically, and then you sort of feed in from there. But give me an example of a typical problem, and then how that would sort of expand into some of these other things.
It's very easy to do, because in fact, only 17% at TCMC, only 17% of the time of the year
students
is spent in lecture.
Okay.
So we're probably doing more of this than almost any other medical school.
Okay.
And so there was a session a week ago in which the students were studying liver disease,
okay.
viral hepatitis,
okay.
A very rapidly moving field.
Mm-hmm.
And so one could imagine that the standard way to approach that would be for the professor standing up at the front of the lecture hall
right.
as the expert, imparting the state of the art with regard to hepatitis B and hepatitis C and transmission and vaccination and new emerging therapies and risks of cancer, et cetera. Okay. And the students would try to capture as much of that information as they can.
Okay.
Instead, the way we teach it, there are lectures about that. But beyond the lectures, the students will have an assignment that might be 4 or 5 pages that would include 6 or 7 cases within that. A description of a patient, perhaps a picture of the histology of the liver biopsy, description of laboratory results, and then questions about the diagnosis in this patient. What are the ways you might approach a diagnosis? Is there missing information that you would like to have before you could conclude on the diagnosis? Therapeutic approaches, potential consequences of the therapy, and the students are assigned to come to class with the answers to those questions. And so they have to seek the answers by looking through the literature,
mm-hmm.
which they can much more rapidly access than when we were in medical
right,
school.
Right, right. The internet, that's another
that's
area
right.
of discussion, but sure. Yeah,
and
yeah.
and we expect them not just to make best use of the internet, but also to be selective and critical users of the internet
right.
so that they are able to assess what is good information and what is not reliable information. And so all of this it comes into the classroom in the case-based team exercises.
Right.
And we also provide them information not simply through lectures, but we make available podcasts. The faculty produce hundreds of podcasts, which are perhaps 12 or 15 minutes long, short snippets on a particular topic, which the student can view or not, as they choose, in the middle of the day or at 2 in the morning, as they are working through their answers to these problems. And so we think through all of these mechanisms, we are training the students to be active learners.
So here's a question for you. In the traditional model, okay, the model that I'm used to, mm-hmm. you've got a certain amount of information. You've
yes.
got this amount of information that you need to memorize and you need to know to pass your boards. And there's some that's clinical and there's some that's sort of basic science.
Mm-hmm.
In the model that you're describing, it's a much more individual model.
Mm-hmm.
So people find a problem, as I understand it, they sort of research it and then they come to a conclusion. But are they going, and the answer is probably going to be yes, but I'm interested how you get to the answer. Mm-hmm. Are they going to get that amount of information, that base of knowledge, that what we would call our fund of knowledge
yes.
that every doctor needs to have out there in this model, because it's not sort of a traditional model then. You're sort of picking and choosing, and everybody's picking and choosing something differently, and everybody's learning something different. But yet, you have a sort of set of knowledge that everybody is sort of required to have. How do you reconcile your model, your new model, your problem-based learning, mm-hmm. with the need to have a traditional fund of knowledge and perhaps a traditional language that doctor needs to share with every other physician around the world in order to communicate and have the opportunities that they need to have in a very vast and growing area of medicine?
Well, I actually think that this approach prepares them better for that than the standard approach of simply attending lectures and reading textbooks. But that depends on the cases being selected well by the faculty so that in the aggregate, the answers that the students have to generate to the questions associated with the cases will, in the aggregate, cover the same span of knowledge that they're expected to achieve through whatever means.
Okay.
And the evidence of that is one important the piece of evidence that our students are doing well in this regard is their performance on the standardized exams.
Sure.
Step one, which they take after their first 2 years of medical school and basically tests their basic science knowledge.
Right.
The first several years of the school, the very first classes, had a higher pass rate, first-time pass rate, 98% pass rate on step one for each of those classes. Those very exams actually are moving more towards testing more than just factual knowledge.
And we'll get to that. That's a good point. We're just going to take a quick break here. Again, I am here with Dr. Stephen Scheinman, Dean of Commonwealth Medical College. You're watching Healthcare and Beyond. We will be back in just a minute. Welcome back to Healthcare and Beyond. We're having a very fascinating conversation with our very fascinating guest, Dr. Stephen Scheinman, Dean of the Commonwealth Medical College in Pennsylvania. Dr. Scheinman, we've been talking a bit about medical education, about how you educate medical students, and there's an awful lot to talk about. But that's half the story. The other half of the story is, of course, residency programs and how we train our residents. And having, you know, been involved in this for a while, I've seen a lot of changes take place. But I was reading recently about the Milestones Program, if you will. The ACGME, which is, I believe, the American College for Graduate Medical Education.
Council, yes.
Which I would not try and say three times fast. is restructuring the way they're training our residents. And just for simplification, not to make things, you know, too simple for those who know about it, but the traditional medical education process is you go to 4 years of medical school, and then you follow that up with some residency training, anywhere from 3 to 7 years, depending on what your specialty is, sometimes even 8 years. So that's sort of the second half of what you do before you become a doctor. And I wanted to talk a little bit about this Milestone program, a little bit of why they felt they needed to implement it. Is it good? Is it bad? And what kinds of things is it changing in the way that we train our resident physicians and our fellows?
I think the Milestones movement is a very constructive and valuable development in medical education, and I think will ultimately prove relevant to the undergraduate medical curriculum as well as the graduate medical residency curriculum. And the basic premise is the following. The standard structure, as you've described it, is that you have 4 years of medical school, and if you and you take tests along the way, and if you pass those tests and you serve your 4 years, you receive your degree. And then similarly in residency, there are phases of development during residency that are largely determined by the calendar. A year of the first year, which we some places still call the internship, and then the second year, increasing responsibility, and progressively through the residency, determined by the schedule. And so it's clearly recognized in education that some people achieve competence and mastery of a technique or a capability very early on in an experience, and some people even at the end of that experience may be struggling to master that field.
Yeah, very true.
And so what the Milestones Project is attempting to do is to establish, according to the competencies that have been defined that need to be achieved to be a specialist in that field. And there are categories of competencies and specific competencies within those categories that learners are assessed, the trainees are assessed along the way as to how well they've met those competencies. And the program is assessed according to how well the learners are achieving those competencies. So it creates a more meaningful, more objective way to assess both the learner and the teacher, teaching program. But also, ultimately, people are very interested in exploring the potential to alter the structure of training altogether such that once you achieve competency at a certain level, you move on to the next level, regardless of whether you're ahead of what, where it would have been in the calendar or behind where it would have been in the calendar, so that the duration of training might potentially be shortened for people who achieve competencies earlier.
So to put this in a very concrete kind of a term, let's take a surgical training program, a general surgery program, and let's take a gallbladder operation, which is a relatively straightforward operation most of the time. So now the resident now, instead of sort of clicking off their time and making a check mark as to the cases they've done, they're going to be evaluated individually on how well they do that particular procedure. Mm-hmm. And they get the sort of pass, if you will, when they've achieved a certain level of competence, of ability with it, rather than saying, hey, I've done 30, check, let's go, you can go into practice. So it's almost a quality control measure there in a way.
Yes, that's true.
Okay.
And the competencies are actually quite broad. For example, the competency regarding professional. There's a competency category regarding professionalism.
Yeah.
There's a competency category regarding communication with patients. And there's a competency category in basic knowledge and technical skills and proficiency. And so in each of these regards, you're absolutely right. The learner is assessed according to how well they've demonstrated their ability to communicate clearly to patients in ways that the patient is able then to follow instructions and mm-hmm. understand what's going on. That the learner is technically proficient in the technique that's being taught. And there's discussion among medical school deans as to how we can possibly implement this even in the medical school curriculum, mm-hmm. such that students who master the basic science, particularly if they're self-directed, master it early enough that they can start their clinical work sooner. Mm-hmm. And potentially even shorten the duration of medical school. Logistically, it's going to be a real challenge. But I think that, frankly, TCMC is probably in a better position to pursue that than most other schools are, partly because we're independent, but mainly because we're so new. Mm-hmm. And we're not bound by tradition the way we've always done it, and therefore, how dare you change it? There's not a big bureaucracy. And I should add that one of the national leaders of the Milestones Project, right. Dr. Bill Yopst, is my vice dean.
Okay.
So we have a tremendous expertise at TCMC, represented largely by him, in competency-based education and milestones.
Right. Now, I guess that the other thing that occurs to me, to do something to evaluate and to train people according to this milestone philosophy, and it's really philosophy, if mm-hmm. you will, sounds like it's a lot more labor intensive than just your traditional program. I mean, first of all, it sounds like there's competencies involved. There's skills that they require of residents, and understandably now, that weren't required in the past. And we're going to get to this a little bit, but things like safety awareness, mm-hmm. things like interpersonal relations. It's not just doing the cases and checking things off. But it seems like at the same time, you know, it's a more individualized type curriculum. So probably it's going to mean a lot more resources, a lot more focus on the teaching aspect of it, and a lot more reviewing of what's going on. So it probably will require a lot more supervision, like a serious amount more supervision than was in the past. Is that an accurate statement or not?
Well, I think that it is going to be different from the way we've done it in the past. And right. so whenever a long established method is challenged, is changed, it is disruptive change, a phrase you used earlier,
right.
Then just by virtue of the change itself, it's going to be challenging and difficult for the people who have done it the other way for a very long time. Mm-hmm. But I frankly think that this is what the public expects of us. They expect that when we graduate a medical student, when we certify a resident as having completed training successfully, that what we're saying is that they are competent in all of these elements, not just technically, but professionally and interpersonally, and that if fulfilling that obligation to the public requires taking a little more individualized time with those residents, I think that is our obligation. And one of the basic ways that this movement is being expressed is a so-called entrustments project. It is a project being promoted by national organizations that, once again, Dr. Yopes, my vice dean, is very much involved in, to lead to the point where every medical school dean can certify that every person they are graduating that year is competent in the following 13 categories of skills, and that every residency program director receiving a graduate from that medical school can assume that they are competent in all of those things. Believe it or not, that hadn't existed until now. And so it was assumed that we were training medical students who, when they graduated, were able to speak well to clearly to patients, right, and at their level. But in fact, we've not been doing the greatest job in that regard, and I think much more attention is being paid to that now.
One of the questions I was going to ask you was, a lot of focus has been, and almost for a long time now, on doctors' interpersonal skills. Yes. You know, and interestingly, I was taking a course in legal issues and malpractice and this sort of thing. And one of the things that the course emphasized over and over again was that the way that doctors related to patients, the way that they communicated to patients, the way they would instill trust in patients, their attentiveness, their perseverance, if you will, plays a much larger role in the patient's mind than either the doctor's reputation or the doctor's clinical skill and prowess. You know, it seemed that was a far more important component. And, you know, again and again, I'm sure that you've come into contact with people who have, you know, spoken very highly about their doctor and by and large have emphasized the personal qualities of that doctor. So I guess my question was going to be, and you sort of answered a little bit, but maybe you can elaborate on it just a little bit more. What are we doing to make more human doctors? What are we doing to make our doctors communicate better, more personable, and fill in that whole other dimension, which is so essential to the doctor-patient relationship? And you did allude to some of this when you were talking about the milestones program. And so.
Well, this is something that we pay a lot of conscious attention to at TCMC.
Yeah.
For one thing, we, like many other medical schools, have got a simulation center where medical students, unlike in our day, will actually get a chance to practice taking a history from a patient,
right,
examining a patient on actors who are not patients, but are trained to simulate patients with their symptoms and their complaints and the answers to the questions.
Yeah.
And so the students have a fair level of comfort talking to patients even before they start doing it full time in their third year. And so that's something that many medical schools are doing. But in addition, we pay conscious attention in the curriculum, in the content of the curriculum, to ways to communicate with patients. And I think something that we do that makes a big difference in this regard is our third year curriculum. The standard curriculum, which both of us went through in medical school, is one in which in the third year, you'll spend 10 to 12 weeks in one specialty and then do that intensively,
yep,
and then move on to the next specialty. It's a great way to learn that each of those specialties in intensively and
right,
in great detail.
Right.
But then once you've left that specialty and moved on to the next one, there's no reinforcement of what you learned. Basic principle of pedagogy is that repetition and repeated exposure,
sure,
reinforces the knowledge. But the way we have our third year is a so-called longitudinal integrated clerkship, mm-hmm, whereby they're doing each of the six core specialties simultaneously every week, a half day each, of medicine, family medicine, surgery, pediatrics, OBGYN, and psychiatry.
This is for the third year.
This is in the third year.
Okay. When they, again, start their clinical rotations and actually start to see patients, in the traditional model anyway.
That's yeah, right. And our students have had exposure to patients in their first and second year,
right,
as I described. So they come
right
in, we think, very well prepared. And I hear very often from our clinical preceptors how well prepared our students are for the third year,
mm-hmm,
which is a typical complaint about among medical school deans that they hear from their clinical departments that students go into the third year not well prepared.
Right.
I've heard that very often.
Right.
It's the reverse of TCMC, I think, because of the clinical experience in the first 2 years.
Right.
And during those years, they've had a relationship with a family that they follow through their doctor visits and such.
Right.
Then they get to the third year, and they're doing all these specialties.
Right.
Throughout the whole year, so that when a patient comes back to their internist's office that they saw 2 months ago with
right.
the student,
right.
the student's there again to see the follow-up. And when you and I did obstetrics in medical school, I'm going to bet your experience was like mine. I delivered a half dozen women of their babies in medical school. It was mm-hmm. a great thrill.
Yep.
In every single case, I was meeting that woman for the first time on the delivery table.
And the last time.
And the last time. I never saw them again. At TCMC, they follow that woman through her, that's right. They follow the woman through all her prenatal yeah. visits. And then when she's about to deliver, the obstetrician may call them up, but the patient will definitely call them up. Our students say they can rely on their patients to call them saying, I'm going into labor. Please come into the hospital. I want you there. They deliver the baby and then they follow the baby. And so I think that this not only reinforces the science of the specialty throughout that full year, but it also reinforces the relationship with the patient, the social context of the patient, the way the patient didn't take their medicines because it wasn't explained to them right the first time.
Right.
And so I think this is the reason why our students graduate with such excellent skills in mm-hmm. communication, and we have objective evidence, because we thought it very important to monitor the success of our graduates as they entered residency, to see how the residency program directors who were receiving our graduates felt, how well prepared the program directors felt they were. So we asked the program directors and the graduates 26 questions. How does our graduate compare mm-hmm. with graduates of other medical schools in
right.
your program?
Right.
In every single one of those categories, the mean score was above the score of the other graduates in the program. And the thing they scored the very highest on was the ability to communicate with patients and the ability to empathize with patients and understand their mm-hmm. their situation. They also scored particularly high on overall medical knowledge mm-hmm. and on the ability to work well in a hospital team, which is remarkable to me because so little of our experience is in the hospital. Most of our experience is in doctor's offices in the ambulatory setting. And so I think that all of this speaks to the team skills that are built mm-hmm. into the curriculum from the first year, yeah. into the longitudinal experiences that give them a meaningful, continuous relationship with the patients and also with their physician role models. Mm-hmm. And also, frankly, I think with the kind of student who chooses to come to TCMC, these are the ways in which we are different, and some students will find that very appealing. And some students would rather be in a much more research-intensive school where they'll get much more laboratory experience so that they can go on to become a molecular biologist curing diseases.
It's very interesting to me that as we talk and as I learn about a lot of the things that you've done, it seems to me that the traditional model of medicine, which I grew up on, which was the solo practitioner working tirelessly and endlessly into the middle of the night, undergoing a very regimented medical student residency program, has really shifted quite a bit. There's an awful lot now of awareness of things that are not particularly medical. Mm-hmm. Teamwork.
Yes.
Looking at things from a problem-based perspective rather than simply taking it in. Mm-hmm. Interpersonal skills. These are things which will determine your success as a doctor, mm-hmm. but never really were addressed in the traditional education. So it's interesting to me, but it's encouraging because it shows that, you know, a lot of the changes that are taking place in larger society and the business world, for example, are being incorporated. But not only that, but it seems as though the people like yourself who are in a position of responsibility are listening to what people have to say out there, are listening to the patients, are listening to the regulatory agencies, if you are listening to the press and saying, hey, how can we make medicine better? How can we make our doctors better? It's not just medicine. It's interpersonal management. It's It's communication skills, it's everything. And it's encouraging to hear that because it means that, you know, we will continue to sort of build upon what we've done and continue to have great and even better doctors in the future. It's really very encouraging, you know?
Well, thank you. I'd like to think that TCMC is in the forefront in this regard, and that it stems from the community-based vision for the medical school. We were founded by community members. Our board is made up of people from the community, and their vision was that we produce doctors for the 21st century, in which medical care will be delivered in teams, not by solo doctors running their own private business in the first floor of their house. So it's very conscious in our admissions policy. We received 6,000 applications last year for our class of 100. Mm-hmm. Right now in November, and we've got 2 months to go, we've already got almost 7,000 applications for next year. We could fill 5 or 6 classes with students with perfect GPAs and MCATs. Yeah. So what we do is we are looking at them very closely with regard to their interpersonal skills. The interviewers who help select our students don't even have their academic record.
Yeah.
The academic record is what gets you into the interview. What gets you into school from that point are your interpersonal skills. And our interviewers have gotten very good I think they must be wonderful at figuring that out, because when we need to put a medical student in front of a group to have them meet legislators in Harrisburg, to meet donors, to speak to the community, we can pretty much randomly choose anybody in any of our 4 classes and know that they will have an inspiring story to tell.
Fascinating, fascinating, fascinating discussion with our guest here today, Dean Stephen Scheinman of the Commonwealth Medical School. We'll return in just a few minutes. Again, Dr. Lawrence Rosenberg here with Healthcare and Beyond. See you in a couple of minutes. Welcome back again to Healthcare and Beyond. I'm Dr. Lawrence Rosenberg. We have our guest today, Dean Stephen Scheinman from the Commonwealth Medical College, having a really fascinating conversation about medical education, about residency and resident education. We could talk probably for hours about this. It really is fascinating. Not only the trends that are taking place, but a lot of the initiatives that Commonwealth is pursuing, you know, within this space. We've been talking a lot about medical school. We've been talking a lot about residency programs. I want to take the last bit of our show here and look a little bit broader at our healthcare system and our population as a whole, because there are probably a lot of very interesting things going on in Dr. Scheinman's mind about what's happening in healthcare and how the medical education system is adapting itself to those changes. Stephen, I want to ask you, a pretty significant change taking place in our population now. The baby boomers, as you know, mm-hmm. are getting older, many of them now reaching retirement age, and we're seeing a very large demographic shift to the point where a very substantial part of our population is going to be requiring medical care, more so percentage-wise than it has in the past.
Yes.
We're also seeing a shift in the mix of the American public, if you will. You know, there's been a lot of change in our diversity. You know, the melting pot is melting even more. And so, you know, we're bringing different groups of people together, in that mix. And so we're seeing two very significant changes in the types of patients that we're seeing. How do we retool our system, if I could use that term? How do we restructure our system to adapt to the changing demographics, if you will, that we're going to be seeing over the next 15, 20 years in the United States?
Well, you're absolutely right that the demand for medical care is going to go up, both because of the aging of the population and also because of the growing armamentarium we have got to deal with disease. So the more we can offer, the more people will demand the services of the medical system. And yet we already know that the costs are unsustainable. Per capita, we've got the highest, by far, the highest costs of any medical system in the world. And yet our outcomes, whether you measure them by basic measures of infant mortality or vaccination rates or any of a number of measures, are the lowest of any industrialized nation. And so we're not doing things nearly as well as we could do them. There's no question that at the very high end, the most intensive care that is given is better in the United States than anywhere else. There's no question of that. But the population health is not what it could be. Mm-hmm. And so there are a couple of basic facts that we need to recognize. One is that although there have been 16 new medical schools started, and so the number of medical graduates has grown significantly, and the number of osteopathic graduates has grown even more.
Right.
The number of doctors we're producing, having trained in residency, is fixed. And that's because most of residency training is supported by the federal government, right. And that was capped in 1997 by the Balanced Budget Amendment. And so there's been less than 1% per year growth in the number of residency positions. And much of that growth is occurring in subspecialties and not in primary care. And so, and of course, Congress has no appetite for increasing their expenditure on residency training.
Right.
The Institute of Medicine recently came out with recommendations that would restructure the way residency training is supported and recommend that it be supported at the current level, but not that support be increased. So we will need to figure out how to take care of the American population, growing and aging American population, with a fixed number of doctors. Right. And I think there's no way around the conclusion that we will need to rely more on the entire team of healthcare providers and not just the physicians.
Right.
And so I think it will be very important for everybody on the healthcare team to be able to work at the top of their capacity,
right.
Of training,
right.
And licensure, and for people to work in teams so that patients can know that they're getting the best care even when there aren't enough doctors to go around. So we're all going to get used to getting more care. I often get my care from my physician's nurse practitioner rather than the physician himself. Mm-hmm. But when I need the physician, he's there. There are many, many examples in the healthcare setting where teams are already a natural part of it. I'm a nephrologist. I take care of kidney patients. And the dialysis setting has been a team-based setting forever.
Right.
So I think that team-based care and the expansion of the other elements of the team is going to be an important part of the way we deliver care.
Interesting, because you had spoken, again, coming back to our conversation about medical school, about the importance of being part of a team. And almost, you know, almost now it seems as though doctors are going to have to assume, again, rather than that independent path that you and I grew up in the shadow of, doctors are going to be seen, will necessarily have to be seen more as team managers, if you will, because you cannot do everything, you know?
That's exactly right.
You have to be the sort of the captain of the team and delegate, you know, responsibilities, and then, you know. So it's an interesting model. There's one more thing I did want to touch on with you. Being a medical school dean, you have a very good position in which to view the healthcare system. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of different forces playing now in the healthcare system. We've got, the Affordable Care Act, yes. Obviously, which is still a focus of controversy and discussion for any number of reasons. We've got the very, very, and that being the tip of the iceberg being the overwhelmingly high cost of healthcare, which you alluded to when you spoke about the armamentarium. We have, again, the demographics that we spoke about. We have the economy, which is not cruising at the speed that we would like it to cruise, you know, and we've got, you know, any number of technologies and medical advances, which at the very top level, as you mentioned, take that envelope and keep on pushing it forward. Medical research is astounding as to what it can do now, yet you have a disparity between the top and really the very bottom. So in a general way, how do you see our healthcare system moving along in the next couple of years, in the next 5, 10, 20 years, this whole gigantic system? What do you see are the big trends that are going to take place? And what do we need to do? What do we need to keep in mind as citizens, as voting citizens? Mm-hmm. What do we need to keep our eye on at looking at what's going to happen going forward?
That's a very important question. I think there are a number of very powerful trends that are already moving forward. One example is physician employment by systems. You gave the example earlier of the kind of mentor that we both had, the physicians who were in their own practices and who really did everything for the patient pretty much themselves. Over 50% of the physicians in the United States today are employed by hospital systems, right, rather than in their own practices. And that trend, I believe, is going to continue to grow. It is something that the older generation of physicians is very uncomfortable with and wary of, but the younger generation embrace it, and they're very comfortable with it. And with that comes being part of a system. You lose some autonomy, but you also share a medical record with a large group of physicians, and, mm-hmm, and those patients have the benefit of a large system available to them. The transitions of care within a system are often more seamless. And so I think we are going to see hospital systems growing, independent hospitals becoming parts of larger systems. Mm-hmm. I think those systems that pay a lot of attention to quality improvement and to process improvement and to patient outcomes will be providing progressively better care. And I think that it has the potential to be a good development. I will, mm-hmm, reserve judgment for the moment. Mm-hmm. I think that health insurance is obviously changing.
Oh, yeah.
One thing that everybody can agree on about the Affordable Care Act is that it's not perfect. Most people would say that's an understatement.
Right.
Some people would say it's not perfect because it goes much too far and is too intrusive on the doctors' lives, mm-hmm, and doctors' autonomies. Others would say it is imperfect because it doesn't go far enough. We have to recognize that the Affordable Care Act is a market-based compromise that was originally conceived by a think tank that was seeking an alternative to Clinton's health care proposal.
Mm-hmm.
Yet the very forces that conceived it are now represented by the people who are opposing it so strenuously.
Mm.
We don't know what the Supreme Court will decide about its future in this pending case, which could have a major effect.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it is fair to say that the need to expand coverage remains real. The Affordable Care Act has addressed that in a substantial way, but certainly not completely.
Mm-hmm.
But it also includes a number of innovative opportunities that I think over time will change the healthcare landscape. And one of them is a pilot project for innovation, particularly encouraging insurance companies and systems to come up with different ways to reimburse doctors. Because the paradigm that's existed for so many decades is that doctors are paid by the piece. It's piecework.
Right, right.
And the more you do, the more you get paid, and it has incentivized doing more rather than doing better. And there are real incentives built into the Affordable Care Act for systems and insurers to create different kinds of incentives focusing on population health and outcomes rather than how much you do.
Right.
And there, throughout the country, there are pilots going on in which the results are really, really very promising. The Affordable Care Act also contains funds for innovation around residency training and other innovations within the healthcare system. That remains a very powerful reality shaping,
mm-hmm,
healthcare. There's no question that if we were designing a system from scratch, this is not the system we would design.
No. No, but it's what we have, and we have to do the best with it that we can.
Right.
We've been speaking here with Dr. Steve Scheinman from the Commonwealth Medical College, a really fascinating conversation about medical education, residency education, and our healthcare system. I want to thank you so much, Steve, for coming.
My pleasure.
It's been a real pleasure talking to you in education for myself. And thank you again for watching Healthcare and Beyond. We'll see you next week.